So what are the different modes of, I think I can manage. So, you know, many times these words are very common, you know, different modes of flow, dilute phase, dense phase. What is a dilute phase? What is a dense phase? There are really two ways of talking about it, and we prefer one particular way. How do you define dilute and dense phase? Have you heard something, dilute phase and dense phase? Have you heard this dilute phase, dense phase conveying, dilute phase conveying? Have you heard these terms before? Yeah, so any idea how do you, can you quantify it?
N to S ratio
is different.
Yeah.
Well, I think H to A ratio. Let's do that first.
Yeah. So how much is the difference? I mean, what is the number?
Around 9-10% here and 2%. In dilute phase, it is almost 2% of material, and in 9-10% is there.
So he's talking volume. He's talking mass.
Yeah.
Okay.
Funny guys.
So dense means what? Like 2 milli powders or what? I mean, what is dense phase? Sanjayda, what is dense phase?
1:10 to 1:12.
Okay, so that's another, it's 90%. Yeah. Okay. Some earlier times, in earlier times, earlier means 20-30 years back, some people used to say, you know, we should either say velocity. If the velocity is more than 15 meters per second, then it is dilute phase. If it is less than 15 meters per second, then it is dense phase. Okay. Then they used to have this M star or mass. What is called phase density, a solid loading ratio. Do you know solid loading ratio? Mass flow rate of the solid divided by mass flow rate of the air. Mass flow rate of solid divided by mass flow rate of air in the same units, of course. So that is dimensionless. So if that is more than 15, then it is dense. If that is less than 15, then it is dilute. Okay. Now just go back a little bit. I have shown you a few fly ash pictures. Do you think that is as simple? Do you think it's going to be that simple? You had seen that only in fly ash you had so many different types of products. They look very different. So many types of bulk solids, you know, matches to potato chips to bricks to wood chips and fish and all sort of things, right? Can we really say that it's a 15 and something happens? It is just like a line of control, you know, this like this, this like that. Intuitively, I think by now we can sort of start to appreciate that no, we probably require something else to say whether it is dense or dilute, okay? We'll see that, we'll see. I mean, first of all, we'll see, can we at all have a differentiation between dense and dilute? And if we have, then what's going to be that boundary? Okay, we'll see that. But all I need you to appreciate by now, that it's not a single number which can do that job for you, okay? How we define it, I just need to close on video, just a moment. Tell me whether this is dense phase or dilute phase.
Peter knows these videos. Peter, you have those videos with you, right? Yeah. So it's dilute phase. Do you all agree this is dilute? It's dilute, okay. Why do you say that it's dilute? What makes you say that this is dilute?
Because it is suspension.
It is suspension.
All particles are suspended.
Particles are suspended, okay? Particles are suspended. Now, if I reduce the velocity, what will happen?
They will start falling.
Will all the particles fall together?
No.
Heavier or not? Some particles will fall probably first, and then the other side will fall. Okay. Then, Once they fall, can you make them to move? Will they still slide? Or they will just sit over there?
Sand dune floor.
It will be sand dune floor. If it is brick, then? Or if it is sand? Or if it is... okay, if it is stone chips, will the just sit?
You get a vertical section on a bank.
Okay.
And it start clogging.
So now one thing for sure. Now you are absolutely right in saying that this is dilute phase. You are also absolutely right in saying that we are calling it dilute phase because it is a suspension flow, and that's how we define dilute phase. So suspension flow, we call that dilute phase. This also tells us, I mean, look, Ron says, if you have to take something in suspension, you need a lot of velocity, it's a lot of air flow, a lot of fluid flow, right? You need that. So in dilute phase, you require high velocity and a lot of air. I mean, you give tremendous amount of velocity, everything is going to fly, okay? But is it good? I mean, can you afford that all the time? Or do you like to cut down the operating cost? You like to cut down the operating cost, right? So what do you do? Increase pressure, then if you increase the available pressure, then maybe you will have more flow, higher velocity. So what do? We cut down the velocity, okay? Let's see what happens. Now I'm going to show you another video, and you're going to tell me
what type of flow it is. Takes a little while.
Space. Okay. Is it dilute or dense space?
Dense space.
Dense space. Okay, I'll come back to this video again.
Now I'll show you another video. It would have been nice to sort of run them parallelly. But anyway.
This is also dense space. Okay. But they don't look similar. The earlier video and this one, they don't look
black
similar.
Black.
So what are the differences between these? One thing for sure, they are both dense space. Okay. But they are probably, it is right for us to tell that they are different types of dense space. They are not same. Right? Which one is more turbulent?
First one.
Okay. Peter, this is slack or?
No velocity, slack flow.
No velocity, slack flow.
Corn.
Corn
kernel.
You said non-strong, this is beer.
No, it's another one. This one's corn.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is this conveying again?
Sorry?
Yes, it is pneumatic conveying.
Pneumatic conveying, but probably this is a more super slow, more
slow.
Yeah. So we agree to something that if it is a suspension flow, it is dilute phase. Yeah, if it is a non-suspension flow, it is dense phase. In dense phase, depending on the type of product, you can have different types of dense phase. Right. So broadly, dilute and dense. Under dense, depending on the product characteristics, you can have low velocity slack flow. So the last video was a low velocity slack flow. You can have plug flow also. I think that's for very fine powder, is it? Plug flow?
Cohesive plug flow.
Yeah, for cohesive powders.
Fatty powders.
You have plug flow, and for powders which can retain air, example fly ash, cement, you have fluidized dense phase. So FDP is is a fluidized dense phase type flow. So all that dense phase, okay? So anything can be conveyed in dilute phase. Fluidized dense phase means it's a fine powder, fly ash, cement, etc. Black flow means again fine powder but cohesive. If it is permeable and granular material, then it will go in low velocity slug flow. Okay?
Example for fine and cohesive?
Peter, I think skim milk powder, fine and.
For cohesive slug flow?
Yeah.
Full cream milk powder.
Full cream milk powder, yeah.
Cocoa? Cocoa powder?
Yeah. So, next one, please. Alright, so now let's see that rather than just saying this is large, this is big, this is fine, this is cohesive, can we have some sort of a more scientific approach to differentiate between the different types of powder? There was a scientist called Gelder, he's a chemical engineer, so he did a lot of tests on fluidization and he developed a diagram such as this. First of all, let us see what do we have in the y-axis. So we have particle density minus the gas density. So effectively, this is particle density in the y-axis. In the x-axis, we have mean diameter of the particle. Okay, and then he has given some boundaries. So this is boundary 1, this is boundary 2, this is boundary 3. Okay, the products which are here, A category, that's called Gelder A type material, they fluidize, when they fluidize, they can retain air. Okay? They show a typical, this is not plug, this is typical slugging characteristics in fluidization, and these are cohesive products. Alright, so this is a material classification diagram. We call it a material classification diagram. But this diagram was made by Gelder for mainly chemical engineering applications, fluidization. Okay? The disadvantage of this diagram was this was not meant for, originally not meant for pneumatic conveying. Alright. The other disadvantage was Gelder tested a lot of products, but they were mainly mono-sized products. Whereas for pneumatic conveying, many times, especially for fine products, we get a large particle size distribution. So there is another diagram I'm going to share with you. So Dr. Pan in 1990. Year would be changed, is 1999. So he conveyed a lot of products in pneumatic conveying. So not just a fluidization test, right? In pneumatic conveying, and he gave a diagram. So this diagram, in here we have three parts. So this is the first line of control. So XY, here, this zone is PC1. This is known as PC1. First, okay, before that, one change here, not particle density anymore. Because in pneumatic conveying, the bulk density is probably more dominant, plays a more dominant role. Here you have median particle diameter. So in the x-axis, Gelder and Pan diagram, they are same. The change is in the y-axis. Okay. So here you have loose pore bulk density. So this is my first boundary. On this side, I have PC1. Is it written anymore? So PC1, all these products, smooth transition from dilute to fluidized dense phase. So these are the products which can go in fluidized dense phase. Okay, so fine powders which can retain air. What I mean by retain air is, so you take a column, you take a beaker, you have a fluidization chamber, you have some fine ash, right, and you give some air from the top, from the bottom, sorry. I have some fluidization videos also. So what happens, the bed actually expands. Now if you turn off the air, for some time it retains that air. So when the product retains that air, so it becomes aerated, right? So what happens? What happens to the friction of the product? It reduces the friction, right? So if there is a product which can retain the air, that's great. Then you can, it's kind of a pseudo fluid, it's like a pseudo liquid. You can make it to flow. Just go back to there. Yeah. So this is one boundary, this is another boundary. So what do I get here? These black points. So dilute phase unstable zone. Okay, so these are They can go in dilute phase. They can also go in slug flow. Okay. Again, I tell you, everything can go in dilute phase. So that's not a big deal. The question is, can they go in dense phase? Some materials will not go in dense phase. Okay. This is the one which is dilute phase only. That means, if you don't look at this, use your common sense. Use your common sense. So high density and high particle size, they can only go in dilute phase. Okay. So you have a suspension flow. You reduce the air. If your product comes in this zone, you reduce the air. So at one moment, what is going to happen? The product is going to fall in the line. Will it go further? Will it go further? It will go further if it is somewhere here. If it is somewhere here. Everything goes in dilute. Reduce the velocity below the saltation velocity or pickup velocity. Sorry, saltation velocity. There's a difference between saltation velocity and pickup velocity. What is the difference? So are the same. Which one is more? Saltation velocity or pickup velocity?
Pickup
velocity is more. Okay. Saltation velocity is the velocity where the products will settle. Pickup velocity is the velocity where they will fly off again. Why pickup velocity is little more? That's because the product has to come out of the bond of the surrounding particles, so you require some extra energy to liberate them first. So if you reduce the velocity, everything is going to fall off. But then these products, larger, bigger, heavier, they will not flow. They will just simply settle in the line. These guys will flow. They will also flow. It will flow in dense. This will also flow in dense. But this will have certain flow characteristics, and that is called what type of dense phase? Fluidized dense phase. And this will go in slug type flow. Okay. Now, if I just go back to the Gelder diagram, this is your fluidized dense phase zone. This is your slug flow zone. Please repeat as slug. And this is your plug flow zone, where it is very fine. Okay. But again, this diagram was not originally meant for pneumatic conveying. So you can just use it as a rough guideline, but not as a final statement. Okay.
So if we don't have this velocity enough to carry the to maintain the dilute flow,
yeah,
so we're saying that certain particles are going to sort of fall down.
Fall off. Yeah.
Fall off. So will those be drifted along the question which you had initially raised? I didn't get it. Will those be drifted along with the flow, or they're going to stay right in
that one depends spot? On the type of product you have.
Okay.
If it is dilute phase product only, they are just going to stay there.
Right.
I mean, they can just roll a little bit, you know, but they will not be conveyed.
Correct.
If you have A-type product, it will be conveyed in fluidized dense phase. If you have the other one, you know, PC2, then it will be conveyed in slug type flow. Okay. Now, if you have got a product in your hand, you know, some particular powder, which is having a size of say 80 micron, or 20 micron, 100 micron, and you have to evaluate straight away that whether it will go in dense phase or dilute phase. What to do with that? Okay. What you can do is you can take this diagram. Because out of all the material classification diagram, this was the only diagram which has been developed for pneumatic conveying, especially having some horizontal conveying portion. You can take that diagram and you can see that where it is falling, in which zone it is falling. Okay, so you must be knowing the loose board part density. You must be knowing the D50 average size, and you can see where it is falling. Okay. But again, that's a rough estimation. You have a problem if it falls here. If it falls on this line or just here, then it's a problem. Why? Because that becomes into the uncertain zone. See, you have to understand, these are all bulk solids. So the fly ash you will have here, and the fly ash he had over there in some other place, that they may not be exactly same. Okay? So it is always better, you know, if you have the access to a test facility, some pilot plant, it is always better that you test the material. You test the material and see, and you can straight away know. You know, you have a side glass in the line and you straight away know that whether this can go in dense phase or dilute phase. But yes, of course, once you do a lot of conveying, you sort of have an idea that whether it will go or not. Alright, so there's another way to get some idea about it is to use a fluidization chamber. Okay? So we have a fluidization chamber at our university, at our laboratory. So we have a variable speed control blower. We have got this fluidization chamber, right? And here we wanted to see the fluidization characteristics or the deaeration characteristics of different types of fly ash. So we had some fly ash. We took it from seven different ESP fields. So here I am showing only four fields. What are those? Field number one, field two, field four, and field seven. Okay. So you know that you expect to get the highest particle size here, and then it goes down, and that's what we got. All right. Then
we took some photographs of it. So this is the largest. This is the field one ash. So you can see some spherical particles. Field one ash. Then you have the field, this is the seventh field ash. So you can see a lot of fine powders, right? So that's seventh field ash. All right, so then what we did is we did some fluidization tests. So I'm just going to run some videos on this. We didn't get very good quality fluidization, by the way. One of the reason was that the field one ash was coarse ash. It takes time. So this is deaeration. So this is where we have stopped the airflow, and you can see this is going down. Okay. So if you have something which is only dilute phase material, then what would happen to the speed of the column coming down? Will it come instantly or it will take some time? If you have a dilute phase, if you have a dilute only material,
it will come fast, almost instantly.
It will come instantly because it can't retain the air, and that's why it's a dilute phase material. But if you have a good dense phase material, it means it can retain the air, it has that fluidic characteristics, so it will be there for some time. Okay?
So then we just wanted to do another test just to see. We just kept the sample in the lab for a few days, and we just wanted to see the effect of moisture on the fluidization. And what you can see here, the quality of fluidization has gone down. If you just remember the earlier video and compare that with this video, you can clearly see that the quality of fluidization has gone down. You have more like chunks of material which have got sort of agglomerated. All right, so then we move to the next one. Okay, how to get benefit of these tests, you know?
So what you have got this fluidization column where you measure the pressure, differential pressure across the bed, and using the variable speed drive, you increase the flow rate, right? So then you calculate the superficial air velocity, or the air velocity. So what do? You have the mass flow rate of air, or the volume flow rate of the air. You divide that by the cross-sectional area of the column, and you get the superficial air velocity. So here you have pressure drop per unit length. So you have this bed, so you know the height of it, right? The material height, and then just see what is the pressure drop you are getting across that, and you divide that by that length. So a Pascal per meter you have. So you do that, you know, you start with a what we do is first we start with the high airflow, and then we gradually go down, okay? And then initially it's generally a straightish curve, and then it goes down and we come here. Then we do something else. Then we reverse it, and for many products you get a different line,
and that's known as the hysteresis. But anyway, I'm just showing one line. So you get this line, so at low pressure, at low flow, you have a low pressure drop. As you increase your airflow, your pressure drop increases. But then, after some point, it becomes constant. Okay? So that's when the products, I think in the previous lecture, there was some discussion on this. So that's where the product has got incipient fluidization or minimum fluidization. Okay? So then,
yeah, sure.
So what you do then, you draw a tangent from here, you draw a tangent from there, and where they intersect from here, you draw a vertical. So that gives your minimum fluidization velocity. Now this was for fly ash 139 microns. So this fly ash was the ESP first field ash, okay? Then we're going to show you the last field ash, so that's 21 micron, okay? Now in general, when we read these diagrams, let me just go back. You can see a difference, right? So this is a rather sharp change in the slope. Now, if you see the other diagram, so the change in slope is more gradual, okay? So one way to interpret that is if you have a rather sharp change in slope, then it is most likely to be a dilute phase material, okay? If you have a slow change in slope, then probably you can convey that in fluidized gel space. So that's the implication of it. Okay? So how do you previous, again, just a quick summary. So if I give you some bulk material and I'm asking you, can you convey it in dilute space or dilute phase? The first thing you can do, just to get an idea, rough idea, the first thing you can do is you pick up a classification diagram, see the y-axis, see the x-axis, measure particle density or loose pore bulk density. You measure the D50 and you put it on the diagram and you see in which zone you are coming. That's number one. Number two is you should do a fluidization test, right? And you just see that whether you get a very sharp change in slope or you get a gradual change in slope. If it is sharp, so you can probably you should allow for extra air because that's a dilute phase material. Okay? Yeah, so then we have de-aeration curves. So de-aeration curve is relative bed height change, right? So you have certain height. If it is a nice fine product which can go in dense space, so it can consume a lot of air, it will hold a lot of air, so the height will go up. Okay, so you get a larger height. And then when you turn off the air, then if it is a nice fine product which can be converted in dense space, it will take a lot of time to come down to this original height. Right? So we all did these experiments with the different fly ash samples. The first field ash, within 7 seconds, it has come down. So one of my students, he took a high-speed camera, and you don't require much high-speed anyway, but he took some camera and he found out the seconds, right? So here you come, so you see it takes a lot of time to actually come down. All right, so we are going to do a very quick comparison between fluidized dense phase and dilute phase, okay? So you have seen these two videos. So here you can have more solid loading ratio, okay? Here, of course, because you supply a lot of air, so your loading ratio is much lesser. You use a larger compressor for that, for dilute phase, more kilowatt, so you use less kilowatt for fluidized dense phase. But what is the problem? So dense phase, fluidized dense phase gives you a lot of advantages. High M star, low operating cost, low compressor, reduced rate of wear, but what is the problem? Just imagine those videos. What is the problem? You have got a problem in design. And the problem you have is because in fluidized dense phase, you have a highly turbulent flow. So it's very difficult to design. Whereas in dilute phase, because everything is suspended, so the suspension mechanics is much well known, okay? It's much more mature. So yes, you gain some, you get a lot of advantage if you have a reliable system, but the designing is tricky.